Good afternoon. Thank you so much for staying with Lagos Television and welcome to Sound Health. This week, we are diagnosing autism spectrum disorder, causes and management tips. Also on innovation this week, researchers report brain scans and computer algorithms show high-risk infant babies which might develop autism disorder. I'm Olasunbo Modupe. We'll be right back in a moment.
The autism spectrum disorder is a developmental disability that can have significant implications on a child's ability to function and have social, communication, and language problems. They also have restricted and repetitive patterns of behavior, interest, or activities such as flipping objects, echolalia, or excessive smelling or touching of objects. Autism may be mild or severe. The disorder occurs in all racial, ethnic, and socioeconomic groups. According to the United States Center for Disease Control, the prevalence of the autism spectrum disorder is about 1 in 68 children. It is about 4.5 times more common among boys than among girls. In Nigeria, 2 out of 11 children have the condition. Autism is a lifelong problem with a number of possible causes, including, but not limited to, genetic problems, severe infections that can affect the brain, such as meningitis.
Autism is a big issue. We don't know the cause yet. There are so many theories out there. The most recent theory, which I read, is that women who have been using plastic in microwaves to eat, and the component in that plastic has leached into the food, not water, but into the food. So now they have identified what it is, and when you are pregnant and they do an ultra scan and they see evidence that something not normal, they're now able to test your fluid before the child is born for the level of that compound. So that study is ongoing now, and there's some correlation that this plastic use.
Welcome back. Today on the program, Dotun Akande, founder, Patrick Speech and Languages Center, will enlighten us on all we need to know about autism spectrum disorder. Welcome to the program, madam.
Thank you for having me.
Yes, in basic terms, what is autism spectrum disorder?
If you say basic term, autism actually is a developmental disorder. You don't get it when you're old. It starts from when you're young.
Okay.
So it affects children in three key areas: in the area of speech, in the area of behavior, and in the area of social skills. So speech and communication means that the child is not talking. That's usually the first sign. Oh, my child is not talking. My child is two and is not talking. He's not using his or her words. And I'm worried. Okay. And in the area of communication, they don't communicate. Even those that have speech don't communicate. They don't use it as a communication tool. They use it as a tool to ask for a requesting tool. They don't communicate with it. For instance, they will only say, I want water. Or we have one here that says, Mofejeon. You know, so those are some of the things that you see that tells you that the child has communication disorder. In terms of behavior, the child behaves in a strange manner that people frown out. For instance, the child starts to rock or starts to flap their hands or sometimes look from the corner of their eyes.
Okay.
And sometimes they flick things, they line things up in a straight order. They like things to be done in a particular way. And a lot of times, maybe they are playing with a toy, they will play with part of the toy rather than the entire toy. For For instance, the child can be flicking the eye of a doll up and down, okay, rather than, you know, carrying the doll as a baby or rocking the doll, but is only interested in flicking just the eye of the doll.
Okay, you cited an example of a child being rude, saying, demanding that I want what I want this without saying it with courtesy. Is that a sign of autism too?
There's a third part, and that third part is social skills. They don't socialize. And even if they socialize, you know, limited socialization. Maybe they attach only to mommy or attach only to daddy. Okay. And they don't understand social communication. For instance, crying unnecessarily. They don't understand that the person that is crying is hurt. They can just use the opportunity to beat the person. They don't understand social cues. Okay. For families that, that have children that's have weird or strange behavior, they need to educate themselves first and then extend it to their community. Their community being their extended family first, okay, starting from the cousins, sometimes even their own parents, they need to teach their parents,
okay,
then extending to cousins, extending to the people, maybe school, the community, extending to church, so. They need to educate themselves and then further educate the people around them.
What makes a child to be autistic?
Well, it's because we don't, we really don't know why it's here. We don't know the cause. There's no cause. Over the years, they've been looking at it, no cause. There's nothing you can do to prevent it. And there's no way you can understand it until the child gets to the age of about 2. There's sometimes, well, they say now early, you can know when the child is 12 months. But we usually try to play it safe, to wait till the child is about 2 before we put a label on the child. Because some of them are delayed, and it doesn't really mean that they have autism. They have speech delay. And that happens mainly with boys. Autism too is a boy disorder. Before you get one girl, you would have seen 4 boys. Mm-hmm. So it's in a party of 10, 8 of them are likely to be boys. So we don't want to label them at an early age. We try to let them, let's sit and watch 24 months developmental milestone.
Can you please tell us how autism is diagnosed?
It's mainly by observation, and it's done by a developmental pediatrician. It's not done by, it should not be done by schools, and it shouldn't be done by centers like ours. It's the developmental pediatrician that should give a diagnosis, together with a speech pathologist, as well as possibly a psychologist. In Nigeria, I know they use psychiatrist, but we shy away from psychiatrists sometimes, okay, because a lot of them sometimes give our children medication that they don't need. Some of our children do need medication, but some of them really don't need medication. So we always shy away from it. And in Nigeria, if we don't have the psychologist, we look out for the psychiatrist.
Are there types and stages of autism spectrum disorder?
Yes. We have those that have, like you said earlier, it's a spectrum. The spectrum is like this. There are those that are at the low functioning end of it.
Okay.
There are those that are on the high functioning end of it.
Okay.
For those on the low functioning end, it comes with low cognitive skills, low academic skills, low social skills, low, everything is quite low. For those on the high functioning end, you have high cognitive skills, very intelligent, low social skills, which is also a very big part of it, very low social skills and very low communication skills. So you find out that on both ends, sometimes you can have somebody that is on a low end, start therapy and move towards the high end.
Okay.
So it depends on how exposed the child is to therapy at an early age.
Okay.
So there's a saying that we always like to put out there that early intervention is important and is key. It drives the way that child will develop in the future. It speaks about the developmental outcome of that children as an adult.
Okay, looking at types, I read somewhere that we also have Asperger syndrome,
yes,
and pervasive
developmental disorder.
So Asperger's,
Asperger syndrome are those on the high functioning end. They can go into mainstream school. They can get missed. Some of them even get missed, especially if they're girls, because girls have learned coping skills, on how to manage themselves in social settings. So it's, if for those that have Asperger's syndrome, they can go to mainstream school, do well in certain subjects, will struggle in certain areas. But there is something very, very unique to that individual with Asperger's. And you have to look for it, you have to find it. And they tend towards things like mathematics, things that don't change, science, art, and music. Music is a big, big thing for our children on the spectrum. They really flow with music, both those on the low functioning end and those on the high functioning end. PDD, pervasive developmental disorder, is when they are not sure. They give that diagnosis. The person doesn't fall into Asperger's, doesn't fall into full autism, so they give a PDD. They say PDD-NOS, pervasive developmental disorder not otherwise specified.
Are there other conditions associated with autism?
Yes. You can have autism and Down syndrome. You can have autism and ADHD. That is attention hyperactivity developmental disorder, or ADD, attention deficit disorder. Those are the ones that cannot sit still. You can have it entwined with autism. They cannot sit for more than 1 second. They are jumping all over the place. And you can have autism and epilepsy. You can have autism and dyslexia. So you can have comorbidities in between, you know, autism and something else.
Most parents complain about their kids being restless after sugar intake. Could this be pervasive development disorder?
Sugar naturally works in every one of us. Children on the spectrum, children not on the spectrum, adults on the spectrum, mommies on the spectrum. If you are down, some people, when they are down, all they need is a bottle of Coke. And then, pyong, they are back up again because of the caffeine and the sugar. So for our children on the spectrum, we always advise the parents to stay off sugar. Because we really don't want them to be jumping. So we always encourage them to eat natural food. We find that because our children on the spectrum have what we call digestive disorders with autism, a lot of times, a lot of them have gut issues. Maybe they have leaky guts, that is the holes in their intestine. Food don't get digested properly. So we encourage the parents to try and feed them nutritious Nigerian sweet homegrown food. Stay away from additives, stay away from sugar, stay away from MSG that can be found in Maggi, stay away from flour, stay away from anything that has wheat, because anything that has dairy. Our children don't digest those things very well. But I must say, it's not all our children. Parents need to sit down, look at the makeup of their child, and find out, okay, I'm opening a diary session here to say, I've stopped this with my son. This was how he was behaving. I've started this, this is how he's behaving. It's the responsibility of the parents to make sure that they look out for their children.
What treatments are available for people living with the condition?
There is therapy option. Or I would say there are therapy options. For instance, you have the speech therapy, occupational therapy, behavior modification, academics. You simplify the academics to the basics and you teach it slowly. And then we have music therapy. We have sensory integration. We have vocational services of gross and fine motor skills for the very young ones. So those are some of the things that is important for you to start with when you are dealing with children on the spectrum.
What are the things you look out for when working with an individual with autism?
The first thing to look out for is attention. Is the child attending? Does he or she have listening skill? What is the learning style of that child? Is he an auditory learner? Is he a visual learner? Is he a tactile learner? So you need to know the learning style of that child. And then you now begin to draw a plan in, you know, to work with whatever that child learning style is.
This month, the world celebrated the 9th Autism Awareness Day. Has there been any remarkable achievements in terms of societal inclusion?
Oh yes, we have, from our own end at Patrick's, We've had over 40 children that have come to us that we've mainstreamed. So we let the parents know that it is not a death sentence. It's not a hopeless situation. She's going to come in here. It's not a hopeless situation. And we let the parents try as much as possible to understand that because this child has this challenge does not mean that he or she cannot go on in life. We have someone that has come here. He has behavioral challenges and he's been able to learn a trade. And he's gone into his trade doing what he likes to do best. There are some of them now that we work with. For instance, because they can't get a job outside, then we reabsorb them into Patrick's. So they come back and work with us. And also some of them now that we are introducing to factories so they can help them with their packaging. So we teach the packaging skills here and then they transfer it into the community.
That's on your part. What about the society? What has been the remarkable achievement recorded?
Society in general, I think, is beginning to be more accepting because we have not stopped talking about it. It's not, we are not there yet. We are still a far away distance from it. But at least they are accepting. They are embracing our children on the spectrum. We are begging everybody to support families that are struggling with this. We have a lot of families struggling with, you know, this challenge, and we are begging, you know, the community to open their arms, open themselves, open their homes sometimes, you know, to support these families. It's hard work, you know, working with a child with autism or having a child with autism. It is hard work. You've been hearing the screams since, so you can imagine what we, that's what we go through every day.
The theme for 2017 is toward autonomy and self-determination, with focus on recognizing the rights of persons with disabilities. How can this be achieved?
Well, autonomy means that they need to be able to choose. And we need to try to get our parents not to talk for our children with autism. That's one thing you find in most cases. They need to be, they need to be self-determined. You know, they need to understand themselves. They need to be able to choose. Give them the option. Even try. Some people say, oh, they don't understand anything. It's not true. Our children do understand a lot. So if we open ourselves up, open the community up, for them to have choices. Do you want to go here today or do you want to do? Teach them the opportunity to say no, yes. That's basically what it means. Okay. And we are rounding it up on the 8th of April. We have a walk for autism. Actually, this year we are changing it from a walk to a dance. So we have dancers known as Freedom Park. Okay. So we hope everybody will be able to come on the 8th. So we are partnering with other centers. We're coming together as a group, you know, to do that for our own way of awareness towards autism.
Okay. For instance, you have a center here, and I'm sure there are a couple of centers around.
Yes.
How accessible are these centers?
Yes, they do. In fact, we would say we are one of the very few on the mainland. A lot of centers have opened up on the island, and they do access it. In Patrick's here, we have a program where we support indigent families. So families that cannot afford services, we take them on. And on the 22nd, on the 20th to the 22nd of April, we have what we call a therapy outreach. So we'll have like a consultation. Everybody will come under this roof. We'll invite the community, those that have children with special needs, to come in. So we'll assess them. We will have the assessing team. The doctors will be here. Other therapy centers will be here. The occupational therapists will be here. The physiotherapists will be here. We try to get everybody, you know, coming in. We have a doctor, so, you know, as a team to support families that cannot afford services. Because Patrick's is a small place. We can't take everybody. We can't take everybody free. If we take everybody free, we are just going to go down. But we can help them by introducing them to the kind of therapy that they can do in the house.
Okay. What is your advice to members of the public regarding people living with the condition?
They should please embrace our children with autism. And parents should not be ashamed of a difference. The fact that your child is different from your neighbor's child does not make your child bad. It just means that your child is different and you must treat that child differently. Don't hide our children in the house and lock them up and go to work. The more they are exposed to the community, the better they will turn out. We have a 38-year-old that came to us at 35. You know, and he's doing very well. He's exposed. The more we expose him to us, the better he's becoming. I was with him just now, trying to get him to do some things. And when he finished and he did well, and I say, oh, give me a high five. He just eyed me like, do you think I'm a child? So I said, okay, that is not working for you, Shil. How do you want me to say well done? So I did like this, so he did this back. That's better. Good. That's more like my age. Which one is high five? You know, so those are some of the things we see with our adults. They are there.
Okay.
It's just that we need to tap into that inner man to bring them out.
Okay. Thank you so much for sharing your expertise on the program.
Thank you.
All right, it's still Sound Health, and we've been discussing Autism Spectrum Disorder with the help of Dotun Akande, founder of Patrick Speech and Languages Center. Sound Health continues with Trending and Innovation of the Week. Don't go anywhere. On innovation this week, researchers report brain scans and computer algorithms show which high-risk babies might develop autism spectrum disorder. That's in a moment.
In what they call a first, researchers say they can predict whether some infants under the age of 1 would actually develop autism in their second year. The new experimental technique using standard brain screening is designed to focus solely on newborns known to be at high risk for autism because they have an older sibling who has it. But the diagnostic breakthrough addresses a key problem that has confounded efforts to effectively screen for autism as quickly as possible. Babies typically don't show clear outward signs of the disorder until nearly the end of their second year of life. By using scans to peek into the shifting size, surface area, and thickness of certain parts of a baby's cerebral cortex as a baby hits the 6 month and 12 month mark, investigators found that they could forecast autism risk with 80% accuracy. The Carolina Institute for Developmental Disabilities, University of North Carolina, explained that the new screening approach was tested on approximately 150 infants, more than 100 of whom were deemed to be at high risk for developing autism because of familial background. MRI scans were conducted on the babies at the 6 month, 1 year, and 2 year marks, a time frame during which obvious symptoms of autism are few, despite possible evidence of motor and mental dysfunction. Key brain measurements were then fed into a computer-generated algorithm which generated autism prediction scores based on two observations. First, infants who develop autism by age 2 appear to undergo relatively high brain surface growth between ages 6 months and 1 year.
On Sound Health this week. Please show love and care regardless of one's health condition. You can also join thousands of people across the world who wear blue in honor of millions of people living with autism. For comments and inquiries, please send SMS on 0818153965 or follow us on social media at LCV Social hashtag Sound Health. A sound health is a sound mind. Make healthy living your choice.